how's it going? Welcome back to my channel. Been a while. Let's not talk about it. Let's get into the topic of space planning, because today is all about space planning. One of the scariest feelings in the world of design is having an empty plan. It feels like all of the ideas are racing within your head, and today I'm here to help you overcome that fear, create an efficient space plan, a layout for your client. I'll also include a couple hacks that I created for you to feel like the space planning is not as tedious as it really is. Do not forget to subscribe and like this video, and let's jump into it. To be honest with you, space planning is one of the funnest parts in interior design, because this is where your knowledge and your experience just meshes together and creates a functional space for the client. Let's start by defining what space planning is. So space planning is creating a functional layout where the spaces within your room mingle perfectly well. That's my own definition of it. I'm pretty sure there is something better in Google, and probably I'll put it here. So today I'll be taking you through the process that I take and that I've studied. And I also went through this guy, the space planning basics. If you are studying interior design on your own, or if you're a student, to be honest, this is a really brilliant guide. So you've gotten a project, or you're working on a project and you want to start space planning. The first thing to do is to interview the client, to ask them a couple of questions. The most important questions to ask is about what they're gonna use the space for. In this particular video, I'm talking about spaces that are already built, but the questions are different for each set of clients. So let's say you are working with a retail shop, it's totally different from a residential project client. So in this video, I'll focus on the residential project client. In the initial interview, you want to ask your client about the space itself, who is going to be living in the space, whether someone with special needs, so you can like calculate for circulation of wheelchairs, for example. And you want to get very, very specific. It's not only about colors, but it's about the layout and how it will function according to that client. Interior designers are very close to their clients, and they need to know every single detail about their families and how they will function within the space, so they can prepare the space right. The more questions you ask in the beginning, the better your space plan will be. I have included two links in the description down below for two blog posts about what to ask your commercial and residential interior design client. One of the questions that you want to ask is about their style, their preferred style. Shameless plug. I've created the Interior Design Styles Lookbook. It's on Amazon, but right now everything is on lockdown, so they don't deliver it to anywhere but the US. But asking them about their preferred interior design style while you're planning determines whether the space will be symmetrical, or how open it will be. So planning the space to accommodate their style at the end, you know what I mean? I'll leave the video of it right here, but I'll also leave the link of it down below. The next thing is to observe and survey and measure the space. If it's an already built space, then you would want to ask the architect for an as-built drawing of the space, where you have an AutoCAD file with everything from elevations, from reflected ceiling plans, for all the drawings for the architectural space. Now, this is not always the case, especially if you're taking a smaller project. You usually go and measure yourself, and for measuring, you have to be very, very specific. As a person who had like a mistake with measurements before, and it costed me my confidence in myself in interior design, I'm telling you, measurements are very important in space planning, because they are very high stake. When you start designing, the measurements are the most important thing. So make sure that you have accurate measurements. Make sure that you pay attention to the architectural parameters, like where are the windows, how high they are from the floor, things like where are the columns within the room. Pay attention to these little details and record them down. And that's when you create the AutoCAD file. Now, not everyone creates an AutoCAD file. Depending on how big your project is, you would either follow every single step here, or you will let go of some elements in the space planning process. And when you survey as well, you have to take pictures of the space after this quarantine is over, hopefully. Take pictures of every single part of the space, so you remember every single detail, and you remember if there's something that is maybe missed on the as-built, hopefully not, but sometimes these kind of mistakes happen. So in case whether you have measured them yourself or you have taken the AutoCAD plans from the architect, either way, going to the site, surveying it is incredibly important. One of the things I like to do is I like to use this app, Magic Plan. I talked about it before, but I really like it. Do not depend on the measurements of the app. I'm telling you, it's a disclaimer right now. While I'm making the floor plan, I record the screen, and then it's less likely for me to forget in case something exists on the site and I didn't really pay attention to it, if that makes sense. So that's, again, that's totally up to you. That's my personal process, and I think it's a really important hack. Then you're gonna start your pen and paper process. What does that mean? Well, after you have established the floor plan, depending on the project size, if it's a big villa, for example, what I like to do is I like to go room by room, keeping everything in mind, keeping the questions I had, and you focus individually on one room per time, then that makes it a lot easier for you to do space planning, and it's not as overwhelming as taking the whole project and deciding, you know what, I'm going to design everything together. It just doesn't work like this. While I'm doing that, I create a mood board for each space, so I keep the cohesiveness within the areas, and I look at the circulation on how all of the spaces connect together. And no matter what, no matter how big or small the project is, I'll start zoning. Then doing that, I have a couple methods that I'll show you right now on a different angle, so let's go for it. So I've printed out this and I cut it using my Cricut machine. I want to focus on this room as an example. To be honest with you, this is a plan for an apartment that I'd like to move to. I'm using this example to show you what I would really do if I would want to move there and make sure that I'm using every single inch of the space. The first step is to draw your plan, make it a draft, make sure that it's just for your own reference. Make sure that you're aware of the dimensions. The most important thing is for you to start imagining what functions will go together. For example, I jumped the gun way too fast in the next clip, so this is why I'm recording this now. Once you have your plan sketched, kind of a bubble diagram or like a zoning plan, let's call it, and you can kind of imagine which spaces will go next to each other. For example, this space is for working. Just write the general functions, and then you'll start breaking them down, breaking those bubbles, and then defining the circulation. And of course, now you'll establish the circulation, so you'll know how does the person move within the room is what the circulation is. So you know that they can go to the crafting station. For bigger projects, this serves you a lot more purpose than smaller projects, but you can just imagine how things will flow within the space. And of course, you're just guesstimating at this point, so don't go too wild with the functions. Make sure that they're very general, because you're gonna go in very specific direction once you start doing the AutoCAD drawings for the furniture layout. First of all, if I want to be honest with you, what I do is I will sketch the layout, and I will establish the architectural parameters. So we have the door, any columns or like weird things in the room or built-ins, I'll draw here. So this is the built-in closet that they have in this room, and this is the window. So once you draw your floor plan, and this is a very tacky drawing, I'm sorry guys, but it's been a while. Once you do that, what you can do is bring on your tracing paper. So for this example, what I want is an office space within this room, and what I would want to do is just establish few options where I can place the desk. And of course, I know the measurements by now, and I can kind of guesstimate where everything goes. Realistically speaking, I think a desk would be a really great addition in the middle of the room. I don't like when the desk is pushed towards one wall. I like to look at the window. So realistically speaking, the desk will be somewhere here, and this will be the entrance. I think the computer screen would be here, because then the chair would be here. Why would you place the chair here? Because you want to avoid the glare that's coming out of the window. You don't want your window to face your computer screen. Since I have this area as well here, what I would like to do is create kind of a printing area. You are thinking, right now you're thinking on to the floor plan, it's 2D, it's on the top. Always remember that, because we kind of tend to forget that this is actually a 3D space that we want to kind of utilize in its entirety. You need to think about the flooring, you need to think about the walls, you need to think about the ceiling, and you need to think about it 360 degrees. However, when we start with a floor plan, as designers we tend to forget, and we want to the floor plan to look aesthetic, but in reality what you really want is for the whole room to look cohesive. So I'd like to add a little library or like a little nook for working other than the desk, because I tend to work on like different places, some soft seatings here with lighting and shelving. So you would want to kind of introduce that into your floor plan. And for this area, I would like to also have some more extra storage and a desk space. So if I want to translate this floor plan into a 3D, you need to do this after you've built your mood board, just so you know what kind of things you're looking for, what kind of mood that you want. And now our layout is kind of configured, so how it will function in 3D. Of course, this translated into a 3D model and then translated in real life will look tremendously different than the new chicken scratches on the tracing paper. And of course, from there, what you want to do is explore different options. So you repeat every single option, floor plan option, within the area, and you see how it'll look like before you put it into your computer. With exploring different options, what you want to do is think logically about the space. And if you're designing for someone else, put yourself in their shoes. How are they using the space? What are the functions that they need to use next to each other? Another way of configuring your space is having these little tiny furniture templates that I have. I've digitally sketched them on the iPad, and then I prepared them with the Cricut machine that I have, that Aisha got me. Thank you, Aisha. They will make it easier for you to imagine spaces. For example, if you want to see the configuration of this two-bedroom apartment, you'll see that we have the living room area here. So this is the entrance and this is the living room area. And I'd like to furnish this apartment for myself. I don't know if I'm gonna move there or not. But the thing is, I can actually try. This is identical to my current sofa. So what I can do is I can try to configure the spaces and find out different layouts for the areas. And I can completely explore my options, see what I can do with this space. If you print those to scale, then you avoid a lot of disappointments in the space. And as well, how cute is this? This is adorable. It looks wrong, but it's adorable. Hopefully after this corona thing is over, I will sell these little templates 1:50 scale, and I'll sell them as stickers, and I'll sell them as well as just thick paper, so you can just play around and figure out the spaces if you're working with your projects. Let me know what you think down below and what kind of furniture pieces you would like to see in the collection. I'm so excited for this whole thing to be over so we can get back on track, basically. After you do that, you start creating the schematic designs and create bubble diagrams and criteria matrices depending on the space. Again, I don't at all do this when it's a small project, but when it's a huge project, especially when it's commercial offices, yes, you definitely need the criteria matrix. Doing the criteria matrix and the bubble diagram before zoning actually helps you zone a lot. There is one thing that you need to understand, is that you have to kind of think about the division of the space while you're working with the furniture pieces, so you'll know where the built-ins are, if you need any specific items. And you will add a lot of standard sized items within the space. That's why you have the templates of the furniture, and that's what they use for drafting long time ago, or people still use it. The most important thing to remember is that your functions need to kind of work together. So kitchen design is one of the most interesting space planning there out there. just because, first of all, we all spend a lot of time in the kitchen, but second of all, the best kitchens around the world, the ones that are designed to save you time, as much time as possible. And I think in the same mentality that you would design a kitchen so you know exactly how people flow from taking stuff out of the fridge, washing them in the sink, and then prepping them and cooking them and then serving them, in this exact mentality you need to think about also living spaces. You have to analyze it like you're living through it. You have to put yourself in the client's shoes. What are they doing in this exact area, and how are they saving time while using this space? Because realistically speaking, time is not a renewable resource. Time is finite resource, and that's why when you're working within the space, the most important thing to do is to think about how you can shave like small slivers of time for this person to use this space in the best way possible. After all of these steps, you would create the 3D drawings, and of course you need to create shop drawings, or you can assign someone else to create shop drawings. I really hope that you guys enjoyed this video. Let me know what you thought about it, and please, if you do have a question, leave it in the comments down below. Thank you guys so much for watching. I really hope you enjoyed, and have a great time of the day wherever you are in the world. Goodbye! If you're still here, I want to sincerely apologize for not uploading in the past period. I have been trying to make videos, but it's been really, really, really hard. And I've been in isolation. I've been at home for more than 2 months right now because I was very focused on writing the book. I'm a little bit embarrassed from my uploading schedule. Hopefully I'll fix this soon, and I really hope that you guys will forgive me for my lack of uploads, but I'm really, really thankful to have you. Thank you so much for subscribing. I can't believe we have 8,000 subscribers. That's crazy. I can't even imagine 8,000 people in one room. And I really, really appreciate every single person that's watching, that's liking, that's subscribing. I really appreciate you. Have a great time of the day wherever you are in the world. Goodbye.